to the University of the Bahamas, School of Business, Hospitality and Tourism, and Banking and Economics and Finance Department Production. We are here this evening keeping the tradition of academic and economic empowerment of the individual, and we are pleased that this evening we are having again a collaborative effort between the university community and the Nassau Institute. For those of you who are not familiar with the Nassau Institute, well, the Nassau Institute is a think tank that was established in 1995. The mission of the Institute is firstly to encourage research and promote capitalism and free market principles. These principles include limited government, individual freedom, and rule of law. For the students who are here this evening, I would just like to remind you of some upcoming activities that you, well, individuals in my class, and I guess all students in banking, economics, and finance received a program for this semester of the upcoming activities. Just a reminder of those activities, I would like to say this is our first event for the year, and we're pleased to have Dr. Rodgers. He'll be speaking on the topic, is devaluation in the card. It's something that is of topical interest. So I'm anxious to hear Dr. Rodgers. February 8th, we would have a second event here in the auditorium, and the topic would be, what does downgrading mean, and where do we go from here? So Dr. Rodgers, we're gonna piggyback on what you say, and we're gonna try to develop it even further to inform our students. On February 22nd, we'll be having Dr. Richard Eblin, another friend of the Institute, of the Nassau Institute, and also a friend of the university. He'll be speaking on the topic, globalization and a free society. On March 22nd, we will have a day of entrepreneurial discussion. As we develop our country and as we seek opportunities and answers to questions in the future, we at the School of Business, and particularly the Banking and Economics and Finance Department, want to focus individual attention on entrepreneurship. That is the overarching theme for this year at the School of Business. Again, thanks for coming, and I'm anticipating this evening an engaging and informative presentation by Dr. Rodgers. Coming to introduce Dr. Rodgers, our speaker for this evening, is Mr. Rashad Hepburn, the president of the Economic Society of the University of the Bahamas. Give him a round of applause.
Good night, everyone. Before we introduce our speaker, the Nassau Institute would like to thank its sponsors for tonight's event. They are the Templeton Religion Trust, Go Ahead Biscuits, Arizona Soft Drinks, AID, and Compass Point. Dr. John Rodgers studied medicine at London University in England and specialized in ophthalmology at the University of Toronto. Dr. Rodgers became American Board Certified in 1982, a fellow at the Royal College of Surgeons in Canada, and a fellow of the Royal College of Surgeons in the United Kingdom in 1988. On returning to the Bahamas in 1984, Dr. Rodgers was appointed to the post of Chief of Ophthalmology at the Princess Margaret Hospital. and entered private practice the same year. He is the owner of Bahamas Vision Center, located at Harbor Bay. On a personal note, I've heard Dr. Rodgers referred to as a loose cannon, but he did predict a banking crisis, and we soon had the BOB debacle. He predicted a sovereign debt crisis, and the country's rating has been downgraded 4 times. He's also predicted the devaluation of the Bahamian dollar, but we hope this trend does not continue. And tonight, I am pleased to welcome Dr. John Rodgers.
Hey, good evening, and thanks for the introduction. I'm going to talk to you tonight about devaluation. And this is a complex subject, but I'm going to divide this talk into 5 sections and spend a little bit of time on each section. I just go here to advance, right?
Yeah.
Okay, hold on. Okay, so I can, how do I advance it? This way? Yeah, right? Okay. So I'm divided into 5 sections. One, how's the currency valued? Because you have to know how a currency is valued before you can understand devaluation. What is devaluation? What factors lead to devaluation? The aftermath of devaluation, and then preventative measures. So, how is the currency valued? Let's start with that. Now, there's been a lot of talk on the radios and the media about devaluation. And the problem is that a lot of inaccuracies have been spoken, a lot of things have been said are very confusing. So what I want to do, what I hope to achieve tonight, is to explain this devaluation process to you so you can understand it yourselves and make your own predictions. Because when people mention the word devaluation, that's a cause for consternation, for angst. People get very concerned. So I want you to be able to understand it yourself, and then you can make your own predictions. So, okay, let's start with how a currency is valued. There are 3 ways of valuing a currency. 3 are tangible, and there are 2 intangibles. So let's start with a fixed exchange rate. In a fixed exchange rate, a country decides that they're going to peg their currency to that of their main trading partner, and it may be 1-to-1, as we have pegged it in the Bahamas. But it could easily be $1 Bahamian to 50 cents US, or $1 Bahamian to 30 cents US. Depends on what they're trying to achieve. With a floating exchange rate, the value of the currency depends upon the supply and demand for that currency. So there's more demand than supply, and the currency appreciates versus the corresponding currency. If there is more supply than demand, then there's a depreciation. And the factors that determine supply and demand I have listed up here, for example, trade, repayment of debt, defense of your currency. In other words, if your currency is depreciating and you're in a floating exchange rate environment, you can use US dollars to buy your currency to make it appreciate. And in the case of the Bahamas, we have a fixed exchange rate, so we have to have $750 million of reserves in the central bank. So that's the way we defend our fixed rate. Also, flight to safety. When people get paranoid that something may come down, like a devaluation, they take the money out of the country, and that tends to lead to a devaluation. Also, interest rates. This is a very interesting one. What you find globally is that wherever you have developed markets, like the UK, like North America, like Europe, money tends to follow wherever the interest rates are highest. So this has implications for developing countries because it can lead to the flow of money in and out of a country very rapidly. Also, in developing countries, when there is increased liquidity for whatever reason, that excess liquidity tends to go into developing countries or less developed countries, and consequently cause a lot of economic turmoil because the stock market goes up, real estate goes up in value, the whole economy begins to thrive. But on the other hand, When you have liquidity contraction, then the reverse occurs. Then you can have a currency ban, like in China, where the renminbi can vary between $1 US equal to, say, 650 or 680 renminbi. And then you have the intangibles, like the utility value. So what's the utility value of a currency? That's the real value of a currency. What can a currency be used for? What's the main use of a currency? Mainly used for trade purposes, right? For a payment of debt or defense of your own currency. Then is what I call the credibility value. And that's related to the credibility of the government of the country that you're talking about. So if your country has a government that is credible, then it's less likely that that currency will be devalued for a number of reasons. Also, the value or the credibility of the central bank. When Bernanke was introduced, or sworn in, I should say, by Bush II, he said, "This man is arguably the second most important person in the country. Why? Because it's the governor of the central bank or the head of the Federal Reserve who controls the money supply of the country. That's why he's the most important person after the President of the United States." Okay, so there are certain advantages and disadvantages of having a fixed exchange rate and a floating exchange rate. For example, if we have a fixed exchange rate like we do here, one-to-one, there's no currency risk. So if you're a trader, you're importing, exporting, you know from month to month that $1 Bahamian is going to buy you $1 US worth of goods and services. But if you have a fixed exchange rate, you have to choose between having your own monetary policy and capital controls. You can't have both. We've chosen to have our own monetary policy, but we have exchange controls, which are financially extremely, extraordinarily repressive. If you have a floating rate exchange, then you can have your own monetary policy and no need for capital controls. A currency ban is really a hybrid between the two. And for example, in China, they will use their manipulative power to change the value of their currency depending upon what they want to do with their trade. So they'll lower the rate a little bit to boost exports, and then when they want to decrease exports, they will up it a little bit. They have capital controls sometimes, other times they don't. For example, at the beginning of last year, they noticed that a lot of Chinese were taking money out of the country, so they enforced stringent capital controls. So what's the real value of the Bahamian dollar? Well, we say it's one-to-one, but if it were to float, what would it be? So the ballpark value, in my estimation, is if we have $6 billion in the M2 money supply in Bahamian, and let's say the $800 to $850 million in US in reserves, then the real exchange rate value or floating value is about 15 cents. But it also has a domestic value in terms of it being the medium of exchange because it is legal tender. So it has a value to that extent. But remember now, whenever you spend one Bahamian dollar, there's always a US component associated with that because that $1 expenditure, whatever goods and services you're spending it on, ultimately there is an import of a product that you're spending that money on and you have to spend US dollars for that import. So what's its utility value? Well, you can't use it to buy anything outside the United States, outside the Bahamas. You cannot use it to repay your US dollar debt. And you can't use it to bolster your reserves or defend your currency. So it actually has zero utility value. So what is its value? Its real value is its derivative value. Its value is based on the amount of US dollars sitting in the central bank. So when this one-to-one peg was created, the IMF said, okay, it could be one-to-one as long as you have $750 million in US sitting in reserves. So failure to maintain the central bank reserves at 750 would result in a devaluation. So this is a key point. It all boils down to the reserves in the central bank. So let's just define devaluation now in the terms of a fixed peg currency. So in a country, the fixed exchange rate either plans or is forced to reduce the value of its currency relative to the value of the currency of its main trading partner, then that's what a devaluation is. In a floating exchange rate system, if your currency were to keep on depreciating and you run out of US dollars to defend that currency, then that's a devaluation in a floating exchange rate system. So what are the factors that might lead to devaluation? Well, there are a myriad of factors, and they all relate to the sources and uses of central bank reserves. Let's look at some of these sources, okay? Now, if you have a current account surplus, then that means that you are exporting more than you're importing. So you have US dollars actually coming in. We always have a current account deficit, by the way. If you export, for example, tourism is our de facto export. It's a net export of services. So we have money coming in from that, seafood products, mainly lobster, and some pharmaceuticals out of Grand Bahama. Direct foreign investment is also a source of US dollars. Foreign currency borrowing, when we borrow in US dollars, those dollars come into the country and are used at the central bank for whatever purpose. Inbound remittances. So if my friend Mike Alexio has family in Greece and they want to send him some US dollars in the Bahamas because they think things are tough in the Bahamas, that's a source of incoming dollars. Portfolio investment. Now, if we were allowed to invest abroad in stocks, in bonds, in hotels, whatever, we'd have a constant source of money coming back in the form of rents, interests, and dividends. But because of capital controls, we're not allowed to do that. So in the present state right now, that's not a source of income. And by the way, in Bermuda, more money comes in from that source than comes in from tourism. Foreign currency repatriation. So if we were allowed to repatriate the billions of dollars the Bahamians have in foreign currency around the world, we wouldn't have a devaluation problem. Fiscal surplus, okay? If the government's making money, there's less need to borrow money, and there's less need to borrow foreign currency, so therefore, there would be more US dollars in the country. Undervaluation of the fixed exchange rate, I'm going to deal with that later on, as I will do with the paradox of the peg. Sale of domestic assets, when we sold BTC, money came in. Dirty dollars, this is a very important topic, as you'll see later on. When I talk about dirty dollars, I mean drug trafficking, gun running, human trafficking, and now the new dirty money, which has become clean, but still there is dirty money becoming clean, which is numbers money. And then there's the uses, which is really the reverse of this. Current account deficit, import, food and oil, repayment of debt, maintenance of the fixed exchange rate, outbound remittances, repatriation of, say, bank funds, okay, from the major banks. Capital flight, fiscal deficit, poor banking regulations, political and external shocks, sovereign debt crisis, foreign direct investment. I'll explain that in a minute. That seems to be counterintuitive, but it's correct. Paradox of the peg and financial distress. Okay, so let's look at a couple of just economic formulas that you have to understand this whole process, okay? Because it ties in the sources and uses of funds. Every year in the Bahamas, we consume more than we produce, right? So if you consume more than you produce, you're spending more in expenses, which is consumption, than what you're getting in income, which is GDP. So we accumulate debt every year in the Bahamas. You have to look at the balance of payments. So the balance of payments relates what they call the current account to the capital account, and to the change in central bank reserves. So on the current account side, the current account equals the trade surplus or deficit, which includes tourism receipts, dividends and rents, which I talked about before, and incoming remittances. So in the case of the Bahamas, in 2015, that was negative $1.339 billion. Okay? So that was a use of US dollars. The capital account is money coming into the country, like direct foreign investment, external debt, monies that we borrowed that's coming in, sale of real assets, or portfolio inflows we discussed before. The capital account always has to equal the current account. Okay? What comes in must equal what goes out. Any difference is picked up in the central bank, change in the central bank reserves. So for example, if $10 went out of the country through the trade deficit on the capital account side here, and only $9 came in through this mechanism here, then the central bank reserves would show a decrease. They go down by $1 because they have to make up the difference. Okay? So when your capital account is minus the current account is more than zero, the central bank reserves go up, and vice versa, they go down. This little complex here takes a lot of understanding, but this is it in its simplest form. But this is crucial understanding the devaluation process. This and this here. Okay, let me see now. Okay, so let's look at some of what I call the reserve vulnerabilities, the things that predispose to a depletion of the reserves in the central bank. So the macroeconomic imbalances, foreign currency debt, fixed exchange rate, poor banking regulations, political and external shocks, paradox of the peg, direct foreign investment, and financial distress. So let's just look at those briefly. Okay, so if you have a current account deficit, as I just alluded to, then you're going to have a drain on the reserves. And the biggest culprit here is this one here, oil and food, right? So in 2015, we had about 2016, we had about $530 million of oil imports. But remember now, the price of oil went down. Because the previous year, 2015, it was $800 million. Food, another big one. Dividends, interest, and rents, non-existent because of capital controls. So if you have a current account deficit on a recurrent basis, that's going to be a continuous drain on the reserves in the central bank. Now the fiscal account, that's when government has a budgetary deficit, as they do every year. In fact, we've only had 1 year in the entire history of the Bahamas where we've had a budget, a balanced budget. What happens is, if you have this, there's decrease in public and private savings. So if there's a decrease in public savings, then the government has to borrow more money each year, and some of it has to be in US dollars. If there's a decrease in private savings, then there's a decrease in private investment. And if there's a decrease in private investment, especially in the export trade sector of the economy, okay? So my friend Mike here invests $100 in a business that leads to the export of some good that generates US dollars, that's good for the economy. That's good for avoiding devaluation. But if he does what he usually does, which invests in a new building, right, that has no export value in terms of US dollars. So we now need to direct our economy to investments that are going to generate US dollars. Because Mike can't export his new building. He can't export his new house. Okay, I have to have a talk with Mike later on.
That's what I came for.
Okay, so this is a very important point that a lot of people miss. Okay. Now, short-term debt. Fortunately, we don't have much short-term US dollar debt. But if we did, at this point in time, we'd have a problem, right? Because we're just being downgraded. Because what happens if you get downgraded is the investors who have lent you that money on a short-term basis, they get jittery. And they say, God, what's going on down in the Bahamas? I'm going to pull my money out. So if Mike pulls his money out, then I'm going to pull my money out too. So you get investor contagion. And then they say, you know what? I might keep it there, but I'm going to charge those guys more interest because more risk. So then your debt repayments go up, right? And there's the balance sheet effect, which is if you do get devalued, then the principal of your debt goes up dramatically. And your payments go up, more drain on the US dollars, right? Okay, long-term debt, it's not too bad, but it's increasing. It's now 29.4% of our total debt. And that's happened over the last 10 years because government is consistently borrowing to service the current account deficit and the fiscal deficits, okay? But fortunately, the average is 12.9 years. So that won't have to be rolled over for another 12.9 years. And by the way, we've never actually retired any debt. We just keep rolling it over. Okay, now, fixed exchange rate. I heard somebody on the radio the other day say, the Bahamian dollar will never devalue because it's pegged to the US dollar. And with such authority was said. Unbelievable. Anyway, what happens when your currency is overvalued? You tend to overimport and underexport. If our dollar is only worth 15 cents, Mike couldn't buy his new Mercedes every year. Right? He wouldn't be able to do it. But if our tourism product was worth 15 cents on the dollar, we'd have more tourists coming. So our currency is way overvalued, and that increases the trade deficit and increases the drain on the US dollar reserves. It also gives you a false sense of security. Everybody says, our currency is pegged. No way it's going to be devalued. So governments tend to borrow more in US, more in US. And then when the brown matter hits the fan, they got to devalue. The value of debt goes up. Okay, so let's go on. Now, poor banking regulations. Everybody says that in the Bahamas, we have great banking regulations. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that is incorrect. Okay? You look at Bank of the Bahamas. Yeah, look at Bank of the Bahamas. Okay? Charles Grave, a French economist, has a little formula, which is government debt plus total banking assets, which is really government and private credit. When it is more than five times government revenue, you have a problem. So our government debt is $8 billion. Total banking assets is $10 billion. Government revenue is about $2 billion. So 5 times 2 is 10. And 8 plus or 6 plus 10 is 16, right? So we're in trouble. Reason being, because when a bank goes down, especially a bank owned by government, who screwed the minority shareholders, by the way, who bails it out? We've been bailing out for the last 5-6 years, right? The new warrants issue, the new bond issue, the money the government has pumped into the Bank of the Bahamas. So that increases the fiscal deficit, which means you have to borrow more in US at the end of the day. Poor corporate governance. The Bank of the Bahamas has violated 10 sections of the Securities Act. Sorry, 16. 8 sections of the Banks and Trusts Act. They're insolvent, yet they're still open. Now, if that's not poor corporate governance, then I don't know what is. And then there's the paradox of the peg. Here we go. So here, this is what I mean by the paradox of the peg. The economy is booming. But then the governor's central bank says, my God, things are going well, but reserves are going down. So he calls up the banks. He says, guys, you got to ease up on credit. So the banks, he uses moral suasion, decrease bank credit, decrease in imports, because you need to get the money from the bank to import stuff, and there's decrease in government revenue. That's the problem with the fixed exchange rate. Paradox of the peg. Political problems. Like I said before, the value of a currency, the intangible value of a currency, is related to the credibility of your government. Now, I'm not going to judge here tonight, but you can tell me if our guys are credible, good managers, good planning, any policy deficiencies, any corruption? No. Any inefficiency, any incompetence? Those words all look pretty familiar to me. External shocks, very important factor, because this is what often precipitates a devaluation. If the price of oil were to go back up to $800, we'd have a problem, because the food prices would go up as well. If the interest rates were to suddenly increase in other countries, we might have a problem. If there was a increase or decrease in liquidity in other countries, then we might have a problem. For example, in 2007, the money dried up. A lot of the projects that Mike might have wanted to do that he required external financing for, he couldn't get it. So it didn't happen. Okay, let's look at what I call financial distress. This is a phenomenon that actually can go on for a very, very long time, and in some ways be even more devastating to the economy than a devaluation itself. Because when you have a financial crisis, there's a tendency for things to be cleaned up and then you start again. But when you're in this situation, like say Japan is in, you have stagnation for years and years and years, can have. So it's a change in the economic environment which causes economic stakeholders to modify their behavior in ways that result in a slowdown in economic activity. So in the Bahamas today, there's a threat of a banking crisis. Slow down the economy, right? There's a sovereign debt crisis brewing. Slow down the economy. People don't consume. People don't invest, right? Possibly the devaluation. People say, you know what? If we're going to devalue, I'd rather take my money and take it outside the country rather than invest, right? This can go on for a long time. And so in some ways, a financial crisis is actually better than being in this state of stagnation. So I just say a couple words about the recent downgrade. Obviously, the cost of debt is going to go up. And the banks who have a lot of government debt on their books will have to mark that down, which means they're going to have to recapitalize. That's a problem. The next thing is, who's going to buy the government debt? Next time the government wants $100 million, Mike can't give them all the money, right? The insurance companies can't give them money because they can't invest in anything that's less than investment grade, right? Because they have a fiduciary responsibility to the pension fund holders or their policy holders. The pension funds can't do it, right? Now, the question is, can the banks do it? The banks have received instructions, the Canadian banks, last year. You cannot buy any more government debt. So who's going to buy the debt? National Insurance, who has too much government debt in their portfolio already, and who's going broke? Who's going to buy it? That's when the brown metal hit the fan, when the next $100 million bond issue comes up. OK, now let's look at direct foreign investment. This is a very interesting one. Oh, sorry, look at robustness of central bank reserves. The governor of the central bank said, Robbie Myers made a statement a few months back. He said, we're going to devalue. The next day, the governor came out and he says, we're not going to devalue because of the robustness of the reserves. Well, let's look at these reserves. We talk about foreign direct investment. We talk about tourism receipts. We talk about sale of foreign assets. And we talk about US dollar loans. You wouldn't have to borrow money to bolster the reserves if you had enough money coming in from these other things, like tourism receipts, direct foreign investment. And the sale of assets is really just a one-off thing, like BTC, or say if we sell water and sewage or whatever. That's a one-off affair, okay? But this one, I'll come to in a second, is not the panacea people think it is. And remember, tourism receipts, we got more tourists coming, but they're spending less money. So you can't keep on borrowing in US to bolster your reserves. There comes a time when you reach your debt limit. And we're approaching that. If you look at the private sector, right, people are borrowing like crazy just to survive because of core inflation in the country. You can't keep on borrowing the private sector, just like you can't keep on borrowing in the public sector. So let's just look at the balance of payments in 2015. This is a very revealing slide. The current account was $1.339 billion, negative. The capital account, $300 million, positive. The change in central bank reserves was recorded as $24 million. Errors and omissions was $1.315 billion. So that means that there was $1.35 billion of unaccounted for money that didn't come through the traditional system. So where did it come from? Didn't come from cocaine. The price of cocaine has remained the same. Right? Didn't come from marijuana. We don't produce marijuana. We buy it. Right? It didn't come from human trafficking because it cost $2,500 for Haitian to come from Haiti to the Bahamas. I can tell you that for sure, with absolute certainty, because I know about that. Okay? So $1 billion worth of Haitian refugees or immigrants would be a lot of Haitians, right? Okay? So it doesn't come from poaching, because that's money going out. And that's actually an asset going out, not actually money, right? So where's it coming from? I'll leave that for another day. But we know where it's coming from, and it's a very sinister mechanism. That's all I'll say. I want to leave this place alive. I want to leave this alive tonight, so I'm not going to go into that. But let me just say this. In 2015, there was $800 million of reserves in the central bank. So if it were not for that dirty money, we would have had to devalue. So we already devalued, in essence, apart from if it hadn't been for the dirty money. And you know what? This appeared in a central bank report. And they didn't pass one single comment about this. Okay, so how does all this end up? Well, all these devaluation vulnerabilities can often lead, especially if they're associated with a shock, liquidity or commodity shock or interest rate shock, can cause increased debt. In other words, fewer reserves in central bank, a sovereign debt crisis, a banking crisis, a corporate crisis, release a payment crisis, and if you can't borrow that money to bolster reserves anymore, then you devalue. So, in the classic devaluation model, what happens is the value of the currency comes down, your imports go up, your exports go down, so your trade deficit narrows or your trade surplus increases, right? And there's a reversal of trade deficit, an increase in central bank reserves. But guess what? If we were to devalue, the hotels wouldn't suddenly put down the cost of their vacation in the Bahamas. They keep the same price, right? And we have no substitutes, so we still have to import. So for a period of time, there would be an import, what I call import-export mismatch, and there'd be a widening of the trade deficit. So let's look at that. Pre-devaluation, let's say you have $8 billion of imports and $1 billion of exports. So you have a trade deficit of minus 7. Devaluation, say the Bahamian dollar goes down to 50 cents US, right? In the post-devaluation period, your imports would be $16, your exports $2, so your trade deficit widens to $14. Now there are going to be winners and going to be losers. Who are the winners? The people who have an income who are earning US dollars. The hotels, for example. Big time winners, because they're earning in US, but the expenses are in Bahamian. Who are the losers? Most of you. Because you're earning in Bahamian, but your expenses are in US, right? So that would lead to a tremendous asymmetry of wealth in a country that already has a tremendous asymmetry of wealth. And that's a whole topic in itself. I could talk to you for hours about that, but that's going to require a serious rebalancing of the economy. That's going to assume, for the economy to rebalance, that the guys who are the winners are going to keep reinvesting in the country to open more hotels, to hire more people, so their incomes go up, so in aggregate, their incomes come up to what it was like before. But that's a long shot, because most people are capitalists, and if they're going to make a big difference on the spread, they're going to goosey that as much as they can. Okay, so what are the preventative measures? Obviously, you want to increase the inflow of US dollars and decrease the outflow of US dollars. So these are things that we have to look at in that context. So how do you increase exports? Well, we could internally devalue. This is a concept that is very interesting. If we were to change from oil to natural gas and the generation of electricity, everybody's bill would come down by 50%. In fact, there's been a proposal on the Prime Minister's desk, table, or whatever, for the last 1 year to produce electricity using natural gas for 11 cents a kilowatt hour. Now, what would that do? There are 90,000 households in the Bahamas. Average bill is $400. Let's say it brought it down to $200. That would put $200+ million in the pockets of Bahamians over the course of 1 year. So everybody's relative income would go up. What would happen if Mr. John Rowe, the governor of the central bank, would wake up one morning on the right side of the bed and say, I'm going to lower interest rates to 2%. Everybody's loan repayment will go down dramatically. Be another $150 million in the private sector, another $200 million less in debt repayment on the part of government. So let's go back to the oil for a second, electricity. Hotels pay $37.50 every day to keep one room open in electrical charges. Mike and I could go down to Mexico City, Acapulco, for $35 a day, all inclusive, alcohol included. Right? So we're no longer competitive. Ownership structure. In 2014, there was $3.3 billion generated from tourism and from the financial services in the Bahamas, $3.3 billion. The domestic debt went up by $800 million. So you say, well, how could that be? We generated $3.3 billion from our main industries, yet we had more debt. It's because of the ownership structure. And I'm not xenophobic here, I'm just talking economics, okay? Don't get me wrong, my wife's Canadian. So how could it be? Well, think of it this way. We have a dual economy. We have the foreign sector economy and the Bahamian sector economy. So if I'm in the foreign sector economy, the GDP value for me is a big number. Income is a big number. But there are not many of me around, so I don't consume that much. And GDP minus consumption is savings, right? But if I'm in the Bahamian sector of the economy, I'm an employee. Income is low compared to the GDP or the income of the other side of the economy. But we're consuming a lot because there are a lot of us. So therefore, our debt goes up. And that is the reason why, even though we are generating a lot of money, because of the ownership structure, the debt keeps on going up. So if the ownership structure stays the same, no matter what the debt to GDP is over a number of years, if it goes up to $12 billion, there'll still be an increasing amount of debt. So what are some of the new export products that we can come up with? Well, you know, I gave a talk here not too long ago on things that we can do. Like in the tourism industry, there are many things that we can do in the tourism industry to generate US dollars, as opposed to building another house. Okay? Why can't we own our own cruise ships? There's no reason why we can't own cruise ships. Borrow money just like, what's his name? What's the name of the guy who owns the cruise ships, Mike? Carnival Cruise Line. You know what I mean. Anyway, he started off with a tugboat, okay? Nicky Harrison, right, okay? We need to start thinking about new things, new areas, new products. For example, we could have a flight school here. During the Second World War, the RAF came down here because the atmosphere is so clear. They trained the pilots. Our pilots have to go to Atlanta or France or somewhere else to train at the cost of $400 to $500 an hour in a simulator. We could have our own simulators. And if your name is Mohammed, you can't go to the United States. And even if your name's not Mohammed, you got to go through all of that protocol to get into a simulator, as if you're in the airport, right? Whereas you could jump out of your car and walk in the simulator in the Bahamas. So that's a huge industry in itself. And the training of the stewardesses and all that other stuff. I know Mike would like to do that. I mean, that's a hell of a business, right? And the repair of the aircraft. When Air Canada goes down, they got to send back to Canada for the part to bring it down here, when we could repair it here. That's a whole industry in itself. Okay, dollarization. Now, this is a key point. In Bermuda, they dollarized a long time ago. And now they have $112 US for every $100 Bermudian. Okay? So, how do you do it? You relax exchange controls. You say to Mike, bring back all those US dollars you got in Greece, bring it back to the Bahamas. Because it's not going to help Greece. They're a basket case, right, Mike? Bring it back. And it's estimated that they're over $2 to $3 billion of Bahamian-owned foreign currency in abroad, outside the Bahamas. People like to have their money next to them. That's why people put their money in the mattress, under the pillowcase, right? If he could bring his money back, he would bring his money back. And then you get the hotels, the domestic invest, the direct foreign investment investors to pay Bahamians in U.S., pay their bills in U.S., the hotels to pay their bills in U.S., to pay the employees in U.S. Because right now, when a hotel earns U.S. dollars and it pays Mike in Bahamian, it's costing them money. Because they got to change to Bahamian, which costs them money, to pay him in Bahamian, because they can't pay him in U.S., right? It's madness. Doesn't make sense. So also, we could then use those U.S. dollars to reinvest back in the United States, or Mike could buy his Mercedes with his own U.S. dollars. He won't have to go to the central bank. But the reason why the government don't want that is because they are using the private sector generated U.S. dollars to pay their U.S. dollar obligations. Now, if everybody had control of their own U.S. dollars, then guess what? BEC would have to find his own U.S. dollars to pay his bills, right? So that's why they don't want it, amongst other reasons. Also, we're able to have portfolio investments. Mike could invest in IBM, in Apple, whatever he wants to invest in, right? You could buy your house in France or buy an apartment block, whatever you want to do. And the rents would come back in. That'd be a source of U.S. dollars. Okay, how to decrease imports? Well, clearly, if we convert to natural gas, that oil bill would come down. We need to start producing food locally. That's a no-brainer. Changes in direct foreign investment policies, right? The whole purpose of direct foreign investment is not just to bring in U.S. dollars, but to stimulate the domestic economy. So how does it do that? Only three ways. If you have a $3.5 billion project, you're going to buy a lot of goods and services to make that project happen. Take Bahama. But most of those things are bought externally. So it has no impact whatsoever on the economy here. None. And then when the money comes in, the 400, say, maybe 500 million that came in, it ends the banking supply, right? And it's the money supply in the banking system. So the price of money, interest rates, fluctuates with the supply of money and demand for money. But guess what? It didn't make any difference to the banks here because they exert financial repression on everybody. And then when the project is depleted, it's not Bahamian owned, so all the money leaves the country. Okay? Direct foreign investment is not the panacea governments think it is. Besides, all the subsidies, all the crown land, all the concessions that go into it, the return on investment on direct foreign investment, I would tell you, is less than 5%. Okay, sale of government assets. Well, in most countries, when government sells its assets, they can make some money. But in the case of these guys here, you have to pay somebody to buy them. Crown land, though, is a very, very important one. And I'll tell you this. Crown land in this country is our biggest national asset, and it has been abused and misused by successive governments over the years. There's no reason why we don't we shouldn't have a national land bureau that will have the crown land run by the private sector, and it is accessible to everybody, not just friends, lovers, and cronies. Okay, debt reduction. Now, this is a little two parts, really. If we decrease interest rates, then clearly there's going to be an increase in economic activity, increase in GDP, debt to GDP goes down. Austerity is needed, yes. But austerity is not just increasing government taxes, but it's also decreasing government expenditures. So the government has a half-hearted austerity program because they've increased taxes, but they have not decreased their own expenses. And when you do it that way, what happens is after the honeymoon period, which we're just about to finish now, for every $1 of austerity, or $1 of VAT, there's going to be a $1 to $3 decrease in GDP, dollar for dollar. Fiscal responsibility. That doesn't exist in the mindset of any Bahamian government. Non-existent. Monetization. Now, I know when I mention that, people get excited. But the fact of the matter is, we could print $500 million today, and it wouldn't cause any inflation. And that's something we need to do. So it's really a combination of those four things that you have to do to get the economy going again and not cause any inflation. Now, one of the last things we'll talk about is just debt indexing. If your economy is going well, and let's say you have a lot of equity investment, like direct fund investment is, then no matter what happens to the economy, you don't have to pay any money back. There's no outstanding debt. You just cease to pay dividends. But if you have debt and the economy is going well, you can afford to pay it back. But when things are tough, it's hard to make those loan payments, right? So we need to index our debt, and it could very easily be done to what? Well, our economy is intimately tied to the US economy. So we need to index some of our debt to the GDP growth rate in the United States. If it goes up, you pay more interest because you can afford to pay more interest. It goes down, you pay less interest because you can afford to pay. You can't afford to pay so much interest. The next thing is government bond yields index the price of oil. That's the other big drain on the reserves, right? So if price of oil goes up, you pay less on your debt. Price of oil goes down, you pay more because you can afford to pay more. Next one is the external debt, foreign currency debt, index that to US interest rates. Interest rates go down, you pay less, they go up, you pay more. All right, so personal solutions. We all need to make US dollars. That's the bottom line. You start doing something that can generate US dollars for you. You need to convert your Bahamian into US and then get it out now. And it's already hard to do. You just go through customs, you tell them what you got, you show them your bank statement so they know the source of funds is legitimate, and you take your money out and you invest it wherever you want to invest it, as you should be able to. Do it now, because if there's $6 billion in the M2 money supply and only $850 million in the central bank, and the brown matter hits the fan, as far as I know, $6 billion doesn't go into $850 million. So I just want to finish by saying this. When will we devalue? Well, if you follow what I've been saying, you can figure it out for yourself. But I'll tell you one thing. The government nor the central bank will ever tell you when it's about to happen. You use some examples in Latin America. When Brazil devalued, the central bank the night before devaluation said, no chance of devaluation. So you cannot depend on any central bank or any government to determine when the devaluation is going to occur. You can determine that for yourself. You need to protect yourselves now. You need to get your money out. You need to buy some real estate somewhere in Florida. We can still buy it fairly cheaply. And just keep the minimum amount you need in the Bahamas. Because if you don't, you're going to be in for a nasty surprise. Now, if we do devalue and it goes down to 15 cents on the dollar, then guess what? Mike will have all his money out of the country by that time. He can come back in and buy everything at an 85% discount, right? So get it out now. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Anybody have any questions? Mike, do you have any questions?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, why is my name so
much? You're my friend.
I have one. What about caps on government borrowing to GDP?
Yeah, I agree. Well, that comes under fiscal responsibility. In Bermuda, the government can't borrow more than 10% of the previous year's income. In fact, in the Bahamas, we do have a little bit of a cap in that government can't print, in terms of money, more than 15% of the previous 2 years' earnings and the projected earnings for the next year. So there's a little bit of a cap on it. But we need to have a system where they cannot borrow, period, more than 10 or, say, 15% of the weighted, you know, earnings.
What do you think caused, I mean, in our day, the banks started exchange control because they didn't want drug U.S. money being deposited in the banks. So how, what's happening now, and the banks themselves, we can't deposit, we can't open an American bank account here.
For the most,
so if we start to say accumulate money like we usually do if we go in a way, we get, you know, U.S. dollars from the food store and whatever, and then we take it with us out of the country. So what is going to happen from the point of view of the banks themselves, the Canadian banks holding us hostage in their own way? So we can't even get U.S. dollars as such to open an account. We can open an account in the U.S., but you don't have to put it in your mattress till you're ready to take it out.
Yeah, so your question really is, how do you accumulate U.S. dollars, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, okay. That's why I said you have to find a way to produce a product that you can get U.S. dollars for.
Yeah, but you can't deposit it in the bank. In the
no, so you hold it and you take it when you go out.
That's what I'm saying. You have to hold it in
your hand. Hold it in your hand. Exactly right, yeah.
So,
yeah.
You know,
or what you can do is, if you know foreigners who have Bahamian dollar obligations, then you pay their expenses here and they deposit it for you in the States.
But I mean, you know, why is the government and the banks holding us hostage? They don't want us.
Yeah.
To have any fiscal security.
Yes, because it's a way of controlling you, and it's a way of let's say you want to do a project that requires U.S. dollars. It means you have to go through them, and that's when they touch you for a couple of dollars. Yeah.
So, what you're saying is all illegal.
No, it's not.
It's not illegal.
No, it's not. It's not at all. The reason why the customs have the $10,000 limit is because they instituted that policy because when tourists come here, and if they win at the casino, they want them to declare their winnings when they leave the country. That's the reason why they have the $10,000 policy.
To take the U.S. dollars to the States from the American side, it's illegal for a bank to have a U.S. account.
But it's not enforceable. Just about every single Bahamian has a U.S. dollar account. So they're going to put everybody in jail? From the Prime Minister right down?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, aren't you making the problem actually worse by telling people to bring to convert their B dollars to US dollars and bring them outside the country? Because the more people do that, the less reserves there are, and the more likely that scenarios to happen.
I agree. But if the government were to be to do what it should do, which is enact some of the policy changes and issues I talked about, there would be no need to do that. So you can't leave your hands in the your assets and your wealth that you work so hard for in the hands of these individuals. I mean, if you were starting a company today, okay, a new company today, would you have the Minister of Finance as the CEO of that company? Right?
So,
no, you wouldn't, right? So why should you determine what happens to your U.S. dollars?
You're accelerating the process by telling people.
Yeah, sure, you are. You are. So maybe if that would have happened, they'd see the light and make the necessary changes. Yeah.
Jeff, what are your personal solutions was to change as much U.S. Bahamian dollars as U.S. dollars? But how do you actually do that? I mean, do it in any large amount, you have to go through the dollar premium.
Well, some people are doing that right now. Yeah.
Now, maybe your view is that the paying a 50% premium is worth it to get the money out of Bahamian dollars and U.S. dollars.
Yeah.
Is that your view?
That is my view. Yeah. I've done it myself. It's worth paying the 15% premium to protect your principal. Yes. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Do you have the figure for the monetary base instead of money supply?
Yeah, those figures are available. I don't have it in my head, but they're available in the central bank report.
Technically, the central bank, if it has enough to cover its monetary base, it can de facto dollarize. I suspect they don't, but they don't have it.
I don't think they do. Because remember couple years ago.
But you understand that?
Yeah, I understand.
If they have enough reserves to cover the monetary base,
yes.
If they are like a conversion box, like in Argentina,
yes.
While it worked, or Cayman Islands.
So that's exactly the situation is in Bermuda.
Correct.
Yeah. But,
so
but
if the monetary base is higher than the reserves, then yes, all your reserves is valid.
Yes. Well, that's why a couple of years ago, the governor, Wendy Craig, asked the government to borrow in U.S. dollars to bolster the reserves.
Uh-huh.
And to my knowledge, that's...
It was not used for that.
Pardon me?
It was not used for that.
Well, it never is, right? Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Instead of working on the panic side, wouldn't a more unified opposition lead to a change and then to be able to institute more of the policies that you say are needed to prevent?
You know, Mike, that's a good question. I'll say this. All of the problems we have today in the Bahamas, economic problems, okay, I want you to talk about the other problems, are accumulation of bad policy by all governments. Okay? This is just the tip of the iceberg now, what's happening now. This has gone to the extreme. Okay? But to get any government central bank, for example, to consider dollarization would be very difficult because that's been the legacy of the place. They're firmly convinced that's maintained our economy or where it is or where it's come from. Okay? But the fact of the matter is, that's one of the biggest problems, reasons why we are where we are today. Because it's a false value that we have for our dollar. So it's very hard to change people.
The central bank is appointed by the government. So if you have a forward-thinking government, you would appoint a forward-thinking.
Yeah, but you know, most people understand the balance of payments. Right? It's not something that people spend a lot of time looking at.
Hmm? We have to do whatever we can.
Yeah, but it's up to us to influence them to do what needs to be done. That's what I'm saying. But if you can influence them, then you have to take matters in your own hands and protect your own wealth.
John, 5 minutes.
Okay, yeah. Sure.
One last question. I have a question. Oh, there's a question back here.
Why is there such a proliferation of the Canadian banks as opposed to U.S. banks? And if a U.S. bank, I mean, several of them closed down over the years. That's a whole other story.
Mm-hmm.
But what if more U.S. banks came into the country, opened up branches, and then allowed Bahamians to have U.S. accounts?
Yeah, what we actually need is to have more Bahamian banks opening up so that there would be less expatriation of U.S. dollars out of the country. Yeah. And Bahamian banks that are more in tuned to the needs of the Bahamian people and the Bahamian economy, okay? You know, the Canadian banks for years have made millions and millions of dollars in this country. But when things got bad, what did they do? They shut down branches, they let people go, even though they were still making money, right? And they have not, their fee schedules have increased tremendously over the years because they've lost a lot of interest because of the housing crisis, so they jacked up fees. I mean, even on a savings account, you know, which is what the average person has, there's actually less than $1,000 in a savings account in the Bahamas right now, on average, okay? But they have to pay now a monthly fee to have that savings account. They're paying them 0.03% on their money. They pay a withdrawal fee every time they take money out. So they actually, and if you combine that with inflation, they're actually losing probably on a $1,000 account, they're probably losing, you know, 5-10% every year. Pardon me?
It's not worth it to save.
It's not worth it to save. That's correct. Yeah. All right. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Sorry, ladies and gentlemen.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rodgers. Lots of ideas to reflect on and think about. I guess I'm going to go back to an appointment so that we can continue our conversations. Huh? I'd like to thank again our sponsors, the Templeton Religion Trust. Go Ahead Biscuits, Arizona Drinks, AID, and Compass Point. Thank again, Dr. Rodgers, for the presentation. Thanks for all the people who attended. And we hope to see you in our next one. Good night.